Hello and welcome to Berks Business. I'm Bob Wirt, Managing Director for Investments of the Wirt Investment Consulting Group of Wells Fargo Advisors. Each month on Berks Business, we give you the opportunity to meet the leaders of the regional business community and learn more about their companies. You can also dial in tonight by calling our live during our live program at 610-378-0426. Again, 610-378-0426 during the live program on Monday night. Our guest today is Mr. Bill Wulfsohn, who is the President and CEO of Carpenter Technology Corp. Bill, welcome to the program.
Thank you. Glad to be here.
Thanks for having me back. So a little bit's happened since you've been here the last.
We've been busy.
And well, let's dive right into it. It's been a busy year. Let's talk about what's happened in 2012 and early 13.
2012 and 2013 have been great years. We started our fiscal year in July, so we're actually two-thirds of the way through fiscal year 13. And we've done a large acquisition. We've announced and begun construction on a major expansion of our premium, what we call our premium melt capabilities, which is the materials that go into really the most exciting part of our portfolio. So we've been investing heavily in our business, in fact, investing heavily here in Reading, had over $100 million invested in our operations here. So we're moving our business forward, and we're excited about where that's taken us.
Terrific. You know, you hear so much about the economy being stagnant or people not making decisions. That's different at Carpenter.
Well, our business is focused on, if you will, kind of long cycle industries. They certainly can go through cycles, but we're fortunate that we service and support the aerospace industry, and that is growing. Mm-hmm. And we're also supporting the energy market where, as you know, a lot of materials are used for some of the downhole type of opportunities to get the natural gas. People often refer to it as fracking. And so we've been growing with that. And also we're involved in the medical market. So increasingly we see that companies, our customers, need very special materials to help them achieve their objectives in terms of working in more difficult environments, hotter, more corrosive, and at higher pressures. And that's really what we do well. We are really outstanding at developing differential materials that enable our customers to extend their product lines.
Well, we'll get into what goes on in the specific products and the specific divisions in a little while, but let's talk a little bit about the new thing, two new things really, Latrobe and new construction.
We are so excited to have Latrobe as part of now the Carpenter family. For those who aren't as familiar, Latrobe is a company that has a long, proud history. In fact, they'll be celebrating their centennial this year, coming up in another month or so. And they've been involved also in the manufacture of specialty steels and specialty alloys. With that, they have a very complementary product line, if you will, to ours, very little overlap, but they also support the aerospace and energy market. In fact, over two-thirds of what they do go into those markets. And so it's been a very logical and natural combination. We've been very pleased with the team there, and I think the two groups work very well together. So. In fact, we just had an update externally recently when we announced our earnings and shared that thus far we've seen twice the level of synergies we thought we would have when we completed the acquisition. So really, it's been a great combination.
What is it that you look for when you think about acquiring a company? It's not a decision you make lightly.
Well, certainly in our case, we look for an opportunity to immediately provide benefit in terms of accretion for our shareholders. We try to avoid speculative investments that have long returns ahead of them but don't add to our shareholders' value right from the start. But in this case, I think we saw an opportunity to, again, take a very complementary business mix and bring it together. Actually, our participation or the amount of materials we put on an aircraft now, every aircraft that's built has gone up by 50% with the acquisition of Latrobe.
So you already had the infrastructure in place to support the aerospace industry. Bolting that capacity on is rather incremental and quickly.
And especially because they, at Latrobe, had made a number of investments in the past few years to enhance their capability to manufacture, for example, some of the premium products we sell are vacuum melted. They had put in vacuum melted furnaces, And while they're a very talented organization, we've been doing that type of activity for a considerably longer period. So we were able to share some of our process know-how combined with some of their process know-how, which we also learned from. And I think both companies are together stronger than they would have been separately.
It's interesting and challenging integrating two organizations together. Walk us through a little bit of the mechanics of how you go from the deal to actually something that works together.
Well, I think the first step is that Carpenter is a company that takes pride in focusing on dignity and respect. And we approached Latrobe with dignity and respect for the people and their history. It was really interesting when we acquired Latrobe, and you know, when somebody's being acquired or a company, people are concerned about what it means for themselves. And one of the first questions we got from, and it was a consistent question, is can we keep the Latrobe name? Will we be able to celebrate the 100-year anniversary of Latrobe? And we said, of course. We value that tradition just as you do. And so I think by just talking with the folks there, engaging them in the process of coming together, we told them from day one we did not have a playbook that said we're going to integrate this way. We said we're a team now. So these are the things we'd like to accomplish. Now let's talk about how we can do it together. And they have great people. We have great people. We're racking up a lot of miles on the turnpike.
No doubt.
But beyond that, really, it's the integration has gone very well.
You were doing that anyway.
Yes, we were.
So, how about from a regulatory standpoint? How did that go?
Well, anytime you combine two companies that are as adjacent as we were, the government's interested in making sure that it doesn't affect competition. Mm-hmm. So the government went and we had quite an extensive review. There really was very little overlap. This is a great and unique opportunity where you had two companies very similar in so many respects, but really complementary. When you look at it, Latrobe, as an example, on the aircraft, we supply the materials that go into fasteners. We supply some of the materials that go into the hot section of the engine. They supply materials that go on landing gear and on bearings. So once again, same kind of market, same kind of value offering, but really very different in terms of the actual overlap of products.
And remarkably similar customer set.
Remarkably similar customer set, absolutely.
So how do you... You have the Latrobe acquisition, now you have Athens. Now you've got a few things going on at the same time. You've got a few balls in the air. Let's talk a little bit about Athens and what's going on there.
So Athens is a truly exciting investment, I think, for Carpenter and for the industries we support. As I mentioned and we've discussed, we supply a very specialized type of material into very specialized applications. And frankly, the capacity or our ability to support the industry and their growing demands has been a challenge. And we've invested extensively here in Reading. Mm-hmm. We have basically lined out our capabilities. So we have many operations, but they're well imbalanced here. And the next increment of capacity meant that we really needed to look at starting at the front end with some of the melting and going all the way through the forging operations. And we needed to do that in a very lean manner, kind of a linear process. So we had the opportunity to expand in Alabama, and we're making an over a $500 million investment to roughly expand our capacity in the most premium parts of our business by roughly 70%.
What was it like working with the folks in that part of the world?
Well, I have to say they were very welcoming, they were very supportive, and they were very friendly. We've met with the governor several times there, and he went out of his way to make sure that we had access to the key people who could make sure that we got support from the community and the infrastructure, make sure that in terms of access to our location and things like that, which are very important and practical, that we had all the support we need. We were introduced to local businesses that had also had very good experiences there. So we're very proud and very committed to be here in Reading, and our future, just like our past, is really front and center here in Reading. But I think the addition of our activities in Alabama will be great. It'll help to support our growth.
I'll come back to Reading in just a minute. Let's talk about the talent pool in Huntsville, or in the Huntsville area in Alabama in general.
There's a great workforce there, and that is from all, if you will, types positions that feed into the types of operations we have. Huntsville has been home to NASA's operations. They had extensive operations, which NASA has downsized, and that's really created a large pool of technical talent that we can draw upon. In addition to that, I think the folks who are going to be working on the plant floor, we've had really outstanding people come forward with an interest there, and so we found that it's been a very good experience. Of course, have to start up our operations, so that's right. That's coming in the near future here, but our experience has been very positive so far.
You've got a lot on your plate.
We do, but it's all good.
So talk about, now that's going to be supporting primarily the aerospace industry there?
It will support aerospace and energy for the most part. Okay. I think at least in the early part of our operations, we'll most likely have more energy-related applications down there. And we'll actually use our capacity here to support the growing needs in the aerospace market. It takes quite a while to get new capacity qualified and approved by the customers. And so some of our products goes through a qualification cycle. Some you need to perform or produce to a performance specification. So that's the type of material we'll move down to Athens, or I should say we'll grow. I mean, this is all really meant to take a growing need that we have for our product and make sure we can support our customers. Mm-hmm. So I think we'll be busy here and we'll be busy there too.
So let's talk about what's going on in Reading. You've got some expansion going on here as well.
We do. We're investing over $100 million in our Reading operations right now. If you look at over the last 2 years, we've hired over 500 new employees.
Okay.
So we're very committed to Reading. I'll tell you, we've got a very talented and committed team here. It's amazing. Every month I sign certificates to recognize people who've been long serving with the company, and it amazes me how many I sign that are 35 years, 40 years. I signed one today, 50 years. An employee's been with us for 50 years.
Super.
And when you talk to people and they talk about how their father used to work in another part of the mill or still does.
Right.
It's unusual, I think, in business today to have that kind of dedication, and people really care about the company. That's the feeling I get. They really care, and it's not just because they want to make sure they have a job; it's because they're proud of the company.
Well, senior management generally historically has taken an interest in getting to know the people who work there.
It's true. That's true.
As an effect, I think. So let's talk a little bit about. So what do you make in Reading?
Well, we manufacture specialty metals. Mm-hmm. Which we actually produce. They're typically either in a big bar, if you will, we call them a billet, or they might be made into a bar itself, which might be a little longer or narrower, or a strip, mm-hmm. or even wire.
Right.
And then we sell that product to customers who then form that, and either they forge it or they stamp it or they cut it, and they use it for then very, very important applications that need to have very strong technology to support, as we mentioned before, like, for example, we're in the hot section of the aircraft engine. Mm-hmm. Absolutely critical in terms of performance for the aircraft engine to enable it, and from a quality standpoint, as you can imagine, it's very important. So we work on those kind of applications, which not just the everyday applications, but the very unique niche applications.
So after the break, we'll talk a little bit about how you work with the folks at the customer's shop to learn what to bring to them.
Great.
So let's take a break for BCTV.
You're watching Berks Business on bctv.org. Be informed. Be involved. Be a member. For membership information, go to www.bctv.org/support/membership. To read other stories concerning local businesses, go to www.bctv.org.
Okay, we're back with Bill Wulfsohn, who is the president and CEO of Carpenter Technology Corp here in Reading. And we're talking about Carpenter in Reading. Now, let's talk about what you make here. We talked about what you make here. Let's talk about how your engineers and your team goes out to the customer site and learns what it is that the customer needs.
Sure. So we approach new product development really from two different directions. We We do true and pure research. We're trying to expand the capabilities that metal or the metal we provide can offer. At the same time, we go to the aerospace manufacturers. We go to the aircraft engine manufacturers. We go to the people who are drilling, going downhole, if you will, and we talk with them about what are the specific needs and what can enable their products to work better. And I think a great example is, and this is outside of the energy arena, but we've developed some materials that allow for great strength with much lighter material. And when you look at an automobile and some of the new fuel standards that are out there, they need lighter materials that still protect you and I driving in the car,
right,
but we'll get the fuel efficiency. So those are the kinds of areas or applications where we work with the engineers and we say, okay, is this something that can really add value to you? And if so, if you need it and it has to be of the highest quality,
mm-hmm,
then we're prepared to work on it and develop it with you.
You made me think of like an Illinois Tool Works that develops a patent in one area and then applies it across 2, 3, 4 other areas.
Well, we certainly do that, and that's the end. Like I mentioned, we start off with, well, we have some, we call it custom 465, and it happens to be used on landing gear.
Right.
And when you're landing an aircraft on an aircraft carrier or something like that, you need very strong materials. Turns out it makes for a great material for golf clubs.
Yes.
So there you have it. That's
so that
a good translation.
Using golf clubs.
It is.
Okay. Yeah, I was Bob Carty did that program. He was talking about that very thing when it first came out.
Right.
So on this, which is, it's remarkable the different uses for a particular material. Talking about research and development, you've also been involved in nanotechnology.
We are investing in nanotechnology across several fronts. In our powder area, we are working on nanomaterials. We're also working on it in the with titanium,
mm-hmm,
and specifically trying to focus on helping to enable, say for dental implants, mm-hmm, or for other body implants where you need a biocompatibility,
right,
and you need a strength. And yet you don't want it to be of a particularly large size.
Right.
So that's a great application for it. We're also looking at that material for use as in aerospace, because just like in the automotive industry, the aircraft manufacturers are trying to operate with lighter materials, composites, and they need strong materials that don't weigh down the aircraft.
Right.
So if we're selling titanium fasteners today, if we can use nano process materials to give even greater strength, then that'll benefit us and it'll benefit them.
Terrific. Now, is that research being done in Reading or is that throughout the company?
We do most of our research here in Reading, although we have developed a great network and a great collaboration with multiple institutions throughout the world, and it's allowed us to get access to technology that is new and innovative, but really needs that extra step to make it into a commercial reality, and our team is very good at that.
So you take the ideas that are coming from the ivory tower and from the lab to get that to an actual product must be a fairly lengthy process.
It is, especially in our business because of the types of applications that we're talking about. When we talk about designing materials for a new aircraft engine,
yes,
we're talking about the aircraft engines that will be built in 2020.
Right.
The good news is there was work going on 5 years ago and 10 years ago, which is giving us the opportunities for today.
Exactly.
But that's why our job is not only to make sure the company's running well and healthy for the investors today, but we really do need to invest in our company and in research and our capabilities for a long cycle. And it's true. Our management, we want to see this company be strong for the next 125 years, not just for the previous one.
Terrific. You know, you look at the aerospace industry, and that's evolved rather rapidly, but perhaps even more rapidly has been energy. And literally, this metallurgy has been invented in the very recent past. How do you go through, oh my goodness, here's this opportunity, how do we capitalize on it and in a hurry?
So we really began, I'll say, as some of these new opportunities emerged, we focused on providing some materials that have non-magnetic qualities,
mm-hmm,
which allow the people who are drilling to, they map the magnetic currents,
right,
underground, and they try to seek a very specific point in the earth, and they have very sophisticated sensors they need those sensors protected, and they don't want them to be interfered with by the metal that's around them. So we provide that kind of special material. Now, from that, we began working with a company which was our primary distributor here in the United States, Omega West. Mm-hmm. Really some great leaders, some great entrepreneurs, a great team of people, and they were growing rapidly, and they needed capital to support their business. So we said, well, why don't we work together? We'll acquire you, we'll work with you, and their business has grown just tremendously since we've come together. Once again, great people. We try to enable them with the right product mm-hmm. and the right support. And then what that does is it gets us closer to their customers. And when we talk to their customers, we hear, oh, so you have a need to work maybe in a different area where you need some different attributes. Right. And then we get those wheels to turn, and we say, okay, let's go back to the lab.
And not too long ago on this program, we had Elk Environmental, which does the environmental remediation for Marcellus Shale and that sort mm-hmm. of thing. So it's been remarkable the amount of jobs that have been created here in Redding based on the energy boom that's taken place.
And it's fascinating when you go down to Houston, mm-hmm. Even as we were more or less in the depths of the recent recession,
right.
you wouldn't have had a sense for it down in Houston. The activity level is just, it's very vibrant right now with all that's going on there.
So how do you see the future for that industry developing? It's obviously we have Pennsylvania, we have the Balkan area, we've got Texas. Now that even in suburban Philadelphia they found.
Right. Different people have different opinions, but I think it's great that we have the opportunity to, as a nation, achieve energy independence and perhaps be a net exporter of energy in the future. That being said, we see when you look at the reserves around the world
right.
that actually they're very high in other parts of the globe. So in Asia, in Australia, and parts of Europe, there's great opportunities for Carpenter mm-hmm. and for those regions to basically grow with the same kind of activities we're seeing here in Pennsylvania.
And you do have a facility in China.
We do. We have a distribution center, and we've announced that we are building a facility. Mm-hmm. It'll be doing just initially some finishing activities, not the kind of melting we do here.
Right.
That's a special secret sauce we like to keep here.
Right.
That will give us the capabilities so that we can better support that market.
So is that a market? Is that a place you intend to be going forward?
Well, China is, of course, an important part of the globe. Anybody who's supporting industry needs to have a presence, and we do. Our business in China has been growing rapidly, and it's been with a great team over there, but also a number of people from the Redding area who've been expats over there, and so we're supporting it. Even their aerospace industry is growing,
right.
and so we're always want to be careful about the technology that we bring over from a processing standpoint and from a product standpoint. So we approach it cautiously, mm-hmm. but we recognize that that's a growing part of the globe, and we should and need to be a part of it.
Terrific. Now, changing gears a bit, but you have a new chief financial officer joining you.
We do. It's great. We're really happy to have Tony Tain, who's on board from, he came from Alcoa. He's very familiar with our business and the type of businesses we support, has had really great extensive experiences, and I think as an individual has the type of character and the way of working with people, again, back to kind of dignity and respect. I think he'll be a great addition, or he is a great addition to the team. And Doug Ralph, who was our prior CFO, he made really great contributions to the company. We're really happy for him. But I think with Tony now on board, we got a chance to move forward with what he can bring to the table.
Speaking of bringing to the table, I mean, it's the two of you are going to be out there talking to a lot of investors in general. You're going to be doing the road shows and that sort of thing. How do you balance your time between talking to people from Wall Street and the financial side of the industry versus the internal audiences and running the company?
Well, of course, the financial industry and the people who follow our stock, it's very important that we have clear, concise communication with them. And we do take time mm-hmm. to make sure that we give a very clear story in terms of where we are going as a company. And that does take time. Mm-hmm. I would say, though, that the great majority of our time is really spent internally, making sure that we're doing the right things to grow the business, because I believe that's really what our investors want to see.
That's what they want to see at the end of the day. I read a Wall Street Journal article a few weeks ago talking about how more and more analysts are looking for more and more face time
mm-hmm.
and how that impinges on some companies. But It's a question of how you manage it.
It does, but again, we really try to communicate effectively, mm-hmm. and so I think with the limited time we have with the investment community, I think they have a pretty good understanding of who we are as a company and where we're going. We have quite a number of companies that follow us, and they write very detailed assessments on what we're doing right and areas they'd like to see us improve. And that's so they have a good knowledge and good insight, I think, of how we operate.
Yeah, they're not shy and subtle.
No, they're pretty comfortable.
Carpenter's been around for 125 years. How do you see going forward? What's your vision for the future with Carpenter?
Well, it really starts with what we've done or what the company has done historically, and we want to build upon it. Start with dignity and respect and focus on having the right work environment for our employees. Focus on innovation. Focus on those very differentiated niche applications where we can really add value, because we're not a commodity steel company, and I don't think we would be competitive as a commodity steel company. We have such strong metallurgy skills, processing skills, that bringing those to bear and helping our customers to advance their products, I think that they appreciate us for that, and I think we can sustain the company with continued investment in that area. So we're literally doubling down and expecting that we're going to grow. We'll have new technologies. We'll have some new applications. We've talked a lot about aerospace and energy, but then we talked a little bit about the automotive industry. You know, right now, they're trying to become or get the cars more efficient. We can move from providing a commodity product like a muffler hanger to differentiated materials like a turbocharger or materials that go into turbochargers. So it's those kind of applications that will keep our company moving forward.
Is there any of the commodity business left at this point, or it's relatively?
We have a little bit. We break our business into three categories, ultra premium, premium, and value. Right. As you get into the value section, that's where there are materials which are more towards the commodity realm,
right.
and we have some of it. At this point, it's less than a third of what we do, okay. and we continually try to innovate so that we can better use our capabilities towards the top end of that value offering.
That's where the value chain is.
Okay. That's right.
Well, Bill, I'd like to thank you for being the guest of Berks Business.
No, thank you for having me.
Our guest has been Bill Wulfsohn, who is the President and Chief Executive Officer of Carpenter Technology Corporation based in Reading, Pennsylvania. I'm Bob Wirt, Managing Director for Investments of the Wirt Investment Consulting Group of Wells Fargo Advisors. Thank you for watching Berks Business, and we'll see you again second Monday of next month.